start by thanking the school for giving me the opportunity to come here and talk about a man who really played an incredibly important role in my life. And it's only really that I've come to grips with how important it was by looking at my life with Mr. Gordon, that I've realized, looking back now, I realize just how important he was. And I say to all the students here, I know there have to be some magic teachers, just like Mr. Gordon was a magic teacher. And remember to suck up everything that you can of those magic teachers, because you'll look back when you're 67 years old and realize that they play an incredibly important part in your life. So here are some random memories about a headmaster by a schoolboy. Just like Bernie, I was so impressed by him when I first saw him. Bernie's reference to that amused, gentle smile reminded me of one additional little memory. When we were older students and very responsible, we were permitted to study in separate rooms because we would always be doing the right thing, especially as leaders of the school. And one particular study hall night, I was in that separate room studiously examining a comic book. And Mr. Gordon came into that room, looked at me, bemused, gentle smile, walked over to the comic book, picked it up, put it in the garbage, and walked out. And that just says so much about our relationship. He knew he had me. He knew he could put it in. I'm sure that some of you guys maybe he would have done it this way. With me, probably not you. But with me, he knew he could put that comic book in the garbage and I wouldn't touch it. So, there you go. That's a bit of a wuss. Okay. For all the schoolboy pressure to call Mr. Gordon Dickey, for me, he was always Mr. Gordon. I was a kid who was probably just easily impressed. There were schoolboy rumors that he'd won a boxing championship in the Royal Navy. Never mind, he was a Navy. He was on loan in the Royal Navy, that's right. You had to get that title. But he really did win a boxing championship. And also there was a rumor that he was a commando who killed people with piano wire. And that's the sort of thing that, you know, impresses schoolboys, whether it's true or not. So I was very impressed with him. But he had that presence that Bernie was talking about. So it was a very commanding presence. However, he was one of the nicest commanding presences I have ever known. And I've known a lot of commanding presences. Some I've had the good fortune to know, most of them I've had the bad fortune to know. And so it's a rarity to have a commanding presence that is, in fact, a nice commanding presence. On some Fridays, or maybe it was all Fridays, he made us listen to music instead of going to chapel. That was easy, we didn't have to go to chapel, so it was good. He introduced us to a lot of music, but one piece I remember was the song about Little Jimmy Brown. Just a song about a little boy who was born and grew up, got married and died. Just a gentle little song about life from the man with the commanding presence. Okay. Should have gone to one of his debate classes to get results. Good clean. So he loved to sing, and Bernie's already talked about that. I remember the summers where the Gordons and my family would go up to Lackawanna together. While we dried the dishes after dinner, we would play songs from My Fair Lady, Camelot, and other shows at the time. Mr. Gordon would sing along. He was a good singer, and he would sometimes throw himself into the part. There was one song that he loved to sing about a poor man who went to an Italian restaurant for some spaghetti and ordered just one meatball. And while the waiter was walking away, he quietly asked for some bread. Mr. Gordon took great pleasure in loudly singing, "The waiter bellowed down the hall, you get no bread with one meatball." And I would like to think he loved to sing, and he encouraged us to sing, whether we do it or not. One of my favorite memories of the Gordon family was the Shepherds, the Needles, and the Gordons building the Gordon's cottage at Lackawanna. It was right next to our cottage up there. And perhaps we should have had a professional carpenter come along and help us out with getting it built right. But Dad and Mr. Gordon were like a couple of little kids, probably partly a couple of ex-military men who really wanted a project to plan and carry out. And they had all these willing carpenter apprentices. And so we spent a good part of the summer hammering nails and painting and figuring out how in the world to get the roof up on the top. And once it was all finished, we noticed that the walls had a wow in them. And then we had a lot of difficulty getting the door in the end. I mean, once you built the whole place, you sort of built the thing around this empty space with the door. And we didn't know what we were doing. And we finally got the door in. But the wow and the problem with the door led my father to anoint Mr. Gordon, and he took great pleasure, both of them, in this anointment. He anointed him the Earl of Wow and Door, and Mr. Gordon accepted that as good grace, as he did, I think. I also remember Mr. Gordon starting Sea Scouts. I confirmed with Bob Stewart that it was Mr. Gordon who started Sea Scouts, and he's an old Navy man, so that sort of made sense. None of us really told him that there was no sea in Winnipeg. But we had wonderful canoe trips up and down the Winnipeg River. I remember doing that with Jungle John Whitmore. And it was an interesting experience. Mr. Gordon got me to act. I still remember some lines from Bob Cratchit. And I remember having a soliloquy down in the big theater downtown on the stage all by myself as the ghost of Banquo. But one of my favorite dramatic memories of Mr. Gordon was his reading of A Christmas Carol every Christmas time. And so we would sit in chapel every morning and get a little bit of A Christmas Carol, and he'd go through the whole thing every Christmas. And he was just such a good reader, such a good performer, and such a good story. And that brings me, though, to the greatest gift Mr. Gordon gave me. Just like Mr. Green, who for some reason I can call Porky without any trouble, he taught me to love history. Mr. Gordon taught me to love English. I will leave it to others to talk about the expansion of the school, just as the headmaster already has. But for me, Mr. Gordon gave me a lifetime of loving English, which translates into a lifetime of loving to read and write. My daughter, Caitlin, is now an English teacher. I hope someday some of her students will look back and say, she taught them to love English. If they do, Mr. Gordon will have helped her to get there. Thank you.